because we think like there is not heaven. But when you hear Jesse, you will know that he is heaven. Praise the name of Jesus. And tonight, I have no shame because I have done the background. I said last week, these days I'm doing background check. It is not because I speak the same language with him, but it's because of the God I worship is the God he does worship tonight. And I want you to raise up and put your hands together for Minister Jesse tonight.
Hallelujah. Now clap for Jesus now. Lift those hands and clap for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. Who is able? Amen. I like that song. I like that song. Thank you. God is able. And that's one of my songs on my CD. He says God is able to do what he said he will do. Because he is not a little God. He is the mighty God. Amen. He owns all this world. He owns the cattle in a thousand hills. There is nothing impossible for the God you serve. Amen. I know there's some things that the Bible says that seem impossible to man. But the same Bible says, but with God. Don't you thank God that he says, but with God, all things are possible. Meaning, it doesn't matter what your mom can or cannot do. It don't matter what your friends can or cannot do. But the God we serve is able. Amen. The God we serve is a God who's able to heal. He's a God of salvation. How many believe that? He's a God of second chance. How many believe that? He is a God who sees beyond your mess. You know what I'm saying? He looks at you, and when you're in the middle of your circumstances or calamities, he looks at you and says, if only he or she knew how much I love him. If only he or she knew how much I'm able to change or turn his life around. The thing that fails us is we have no knowledge of God. You can sit down for a moment. What fails us as mankind is we try to put God in the same place, the same little container like our fathers at home. We think that their power is limited like our daddy at home. We think that they can only do what others thought maybe they could do. But we forget that the power of God is beyond what you can think. See, there's a man in the Bible who changed history. And tonight I want to speak to you briefly about this group of men who changed history. And as a bunch of young people, I know I gotta keep it simple and keep it quick. So I'm gonna do my best to do this. Before I do that, I wanna say that I have a passion. I have a total passion for young people. Because 24 years ago, when I was a teenager like you guys, some of you here tonight, somebody came down my way and told me about Jesus. I had gone to this youth camp to have fun. I really had gone to find me a girlfriend, because I heard that these camps are known to attract some of the finest girls in my country. So I went with the wrong reason, the wrong motive. But when I was there on the third night of the camp, the camp leader of my cabin told me about Jesus. And he told me that this Jesus loves me. And long story short, that night in 1987, I said yes to Jesus. And my life has never been the same again. Some of us think when you get saved that your trials and tribulation stop there. But mine is a story that has been told and retold. And many of you have a story of trials and tribulation. Many of you have been through hell and back. Almost literally. But many years would come by and I became very successful. I came to America with a vision and a purpose and a goal and a drive. And now all I wanted to do is be successful, be a happy man, a happy father one day. But how many know the devil is a liar? Amen. How many know that you should never tell the devil your secret? How many know that the devil listens when you speak, because he also has ears? And so make sure you do not expose yourself to him. Because he is one nasty guy. Because I did expose myself to him. I let him hear my secrets. I let him see what I was working on. And my life took a turn a few years ago. And I had worked hard to become very successful, very prosperous young man in Dallas. I had a good name. I was known to be successful, doing well. And what am I telling you, these young people, and even the moms and dads in here tonight? This applies to you too. What I'm saying is, we should guard our salvation. We should guard our lives by living a life that's pleasing unto God. Amen. Because the enemy is always looking around like a lion. And he's not looking for somebody to play games with. He don't want to play a little this and that. He's looking for somebody to destroy. Somebody once told me that a dog don't chase a stagnant car. He only chases a car that's in motion. The enemy looks for people who are in motion, people who are changing their country, people who are changing their family, changing their community, changing their school. He wants that one that can be stopped and change the course of history. So I was a little young mover and shaker in Dallas. So the devil knew if he can stop me, he will stop a generation. He knew that he could stop me, he can stop a bunch of people that look up to me. And he sure knocked me off my back. But I thank God because of Jesus, because when I was at the very bottom of the valley, everything was gone. All the fame, all the fortune, all the wealth. Just like the story of Job in the Bible. Everything was taken away. Basically, I had built some wealth for 12 years, and in about 3 years, everything was gone. I mean, luxury cars, you can mention it. I even had one guy tell me, man, you become the lender and not the borrower. Because I was living a life of the word of God. I was living by the word of God. But somehow I allowed a little room and the enemy took a foothold and changed the course of history for my life. But I thank God because Jesus loves me. And he loves you too tonight. Amen.
Amen.
There's a God of restoration tonight. So for you young people, all I want to say is we're going to get you guys on the right track. You got to start right. You got to have this right foundation. You got to set yourself the right way. What has been my refuge, what has been my help, is I found the secret of being strong is living a life of worship. What is a life of worship? It's a life of total dedication unto God. He's saying no matter what it costs me, no matter what it's going to cost me, I will live for Jesus. No matter what the price may be, I will live a life that glorifies God. So when all the cars were gone and everything was gone, I got a call one time that was the final wake-up call. That they had actually, my father was walking home one day and had been attacked by a bunch of thugs, and he had been murdered in the city of Nairobi. That's what got my attention. And I got on my knees and locked myself up in my little place in Plano.